Next is upper airway obstruction. Suppose you have a patient with upper airway obstruction, how do you intubate and ventilate them? This upper airway obstruction is a very, very dangerous scenario, usually quite common in children, and even in, I think, in adults also it may be seen. So your main job is to bypass the upper airway, and your tube should reach the carina. I mean, your tube should reach a subglottic region so that you can ventilate them. So there can be a possibility that you will not be able to intubate nor ventilate that patient. So this child can just, child or the adult can arrest in front of you. So it is very, very important. So in upper airway obstruction, always it is a difficult airway. So for pediatrics, we usually call the help of anesthetist, but adult intensivist are predominantly anesthetist. So you have the experienced person to do the job and try to maintain as much as possible spontaneous breathing. Try to avoid paralysis, and you are trying to negotiate the narrow passage. So always prefer slightly lower size ET tube, smaller size, because most that is enough, because your job is to just bypass the tract. The lungs as such are normal, so you need not deliver high pressures and all. It just needs a bypass the obstruction, that's all. So in some cases, if the obstruction is like nearly complete and if you're not able to bypass the tract, you may need, or like it is a cannot intubate, cannot ventilate sort of situation, you do something called FONA, front of neck axis. You either do a cricothyrotomy or even emergency tracheostomy may be needed. So once you sort of address the problem, this is already done, I mean, the child overall gets better, then you assess for leak. So if the leak is not there, that means there is some still problem which is happening. Once there is adequate leak, you can again think of extubating such patients. So this is about upper airway obstruction. So next 2-3 slides, I'll be discussing briefly about other minor, I mean, different conditions like neuromuscular, then cardiac, then postoperative, then post-op cardiac, such diseases. So neuromuscular problem, again, it is a pump problem. So basically, the neurology is okay. I mean, the brain is fine, the lung is fine, the airway is fine. It is some problem in the spinal cord or as such in the muscles of the So it is a problem in the diaphragm, or it can be a condition like GBS, where there is, because of spinal involvement, there is muscle paralysis. So because of that, it is usually going to be a long stay. So they'll have recurrent collapse. You can have floating collapses, migrating collapses. Because of the frequent collapses, they'll not be able to cough well. So again, that will get infected. So they'll have pneumonia. The gag reflexes may be weak. So they'll have two recurrent aspirations also can be happening in them. So in such situations, it is going to be a long haul. So by ventilation, if you take complete control, you will cause diaphragm dysfunction, ventilator-induced VIDD, ventilator-induced diaphragm dysfunction. It can also cause diaphragmatic atrophy, and the patient will be very happy and comfortable. You will not make any effort at all. So your job is to take over the work of breathing also, but at the same time, ensure the baby or the adult breathes spontaneously also. So what are the do's and don'ts in neuromuscular problems? You ensure that there is adequate minute ventilation. If the minute ventilation is low, there is a chance of collapse which can develop. You take control, but if you take too much control, the muscles can go into disuse atrophy, which you don't want to happen. In such patients, for example, Guillain-Barré syndrome, you would like to do an early tracheostomy, like by 7 to 10 days, better to do it. Because by tracheostomy, you sort of bypass so much of dead space and the ventilation gets much better. You can do better tracheal toileting. The patient can also handle secretions better. He'll be feeling a little more comfortable with the tracheostomy tube than with the ET tube. Your sedation levels can also come down. So early tracheostomy can be preferred in acute neuromuscular weaknesses. You have a class on tracheostomy, I think, tomorrow. So NIV, again, before you always remember, the patient will be conscious, but ensure the airway is protected. There are two things. Ventilation is different. Maintaining the airway is different. For an airway to be maintained, the patient should have a very good cough and should have a gag so that he does not aspirate the secretions. So before you put any neuromuscular problem patients or a CNS patient with altered sensorium, always remember they have a very good cough and a gag, and they'll be able to handle secretions well. Once they're able to do this only, you have to try non-invasive ventilation. So other thing is called, so such patients are going to be in ventilator for a long time. So in such patients, you would done early tracheostomy. You'll have to condition the respiratory muscles. So in case you have reached a situation where, like, once upper limb power is better, you assume that the diaphragm is going to get better because upper limb C3, C4, C5 and your diaphragm muscles are the same. So in that situation, you work on the diaphragm. So what you do is, there's something called sprint weaning. So what you do is, you put the patient on control mode for 1 or 2 hours, give good control, so that he gets adequate rest, the muscles get good rest. So then every 5-10, after 2 hours or so, you give him a break. So disconnect from the ventilator, just put a HME here on the tracheostomy and allow him to do his own work of breathing, but at the same time, closely monitor his saturation and his carbon dioxide levels by ETCO2 monitoring. So this is like a sprint for him. So he uses his own respiratory muscles to do the work. So this is called sprint weaning. So this you can do it regularly so that this helps in respiratory muscle conditioning. So initially you give this for 10 minutes for him to do, then again put on control mode. So gradually you can increase the sprint time to 10 minutes, then 20 minutes, half an hour, then 1 hour. Gradually you can go up on that. So what are the don'ts is, already their muscles are weak, so over that there is no need to give neuromuscular paralysis. Usually sedation also usually probably may not be needed for most of these patients. And for intubation of such neuromuscular problems, do not go with ABGs. Again, for asthma and neuromuscular problems, ABG findings are not important to go ahead with intubation. So basically, if they're not able to maintain the airway, just go ahead with intubation. Even for weaning from the ventilation in neuromuscular problems, you don't go based on ABGs. For neuromuscular problems, you have to check the drive. So there is something called P100, based on which you go with the extubation. And to know the muscle strength, there's something called vital capacity measurement, which some ventilators have, and something called negative inspiratory force. How much of inspiratory pressure you're able to generate. So based on that, you assume that the patient's respiratory effort is good, and then you go ahead with extubation. In addition to checking for cough and gag, inability to handle secretions. So suppose you have a patient, suppose this is more common in pediatric, they have a chronic respiratory failure. So usually even at home, they'll have a hypercarbia. So when such patients have a sudden acute decompensation and come to you, so they have some acute problem on a chronic respiratory acidosis. So in such patients, we usually don't try to, you see the initial gas to have a very high CO2 respiratory acidosis, and bicarb will be very high. Because of chronic respiratory acidosis, there'll be compensatory bicarb will be elevated. So in such patients, you don't try to normalize the blood gas. And because the CO2, see, for the respiratory drive, there are two things. One is the carbon dioxide, another is hypercarbia is a respiratory drive. Other thing, hypoxia will also cause trigger respiratory center. So these usually have a very high CO2. So their CO2 drive is usually not there. They just depend on hypoxia for the respiratory drive. So in these patients, if you try to give too much of oxygen and try to maintain a normal saturation, their hypoxic respiratory drive will also get abolished. So always give a little lower FaO2 and try to maintain the sats around 88 to 90 in such patients. That is enough, because that will only help in maintaining the hypoxic drive. And as much as possible, try to avoid sedation if possible. In these patients, again, like Guillain-Barré syndrome or neuromuscular problems, your electrolytes like potassium, magnesium, and phosphorus have to be maintained in the normal range. And again, you may have patients who have been operated for different chest wall abnormalities. So like, for example, scoliosis correction. So those patients, again, you'll have to ensure that they again get a low tidal volume. As I said, for any condition, most of the times it is low tidal volume ventilation, because there can be, again, some alveoli may be open, some alveoli may be collapsed. So because of that, you ventilate with low tidal volume and minimize barotrauma in such patients. such patients may need, even if you are able to extubate them early, they may have problems usually in the third or the fourth day. So if you're ventilating for a scoliosis patient or something, first day you may be able to extubate them, or the second day, because of too much pain which they have, they may need a lot of medicines, analgesics, NSAIDs, like then ketorolac may be needed, or even morphine infusions may be needed for such patients. So because of pain, they may be splinting. So because of the splint, they'll have frequent collapses. So there is a chance that they may get re-intubated. So just leave them on non-invasive ventilation post-extubation for 3-4 days, because the problem usually happens after the second day or third day, where they develop a new collapse in chest wall abnormalities. So next is traumatic brain injury. So again, in traumatic brain injury, when will you ventilate them? Predominantly based on pediatric patients. Severe TBI meaning your GCS is less than 9. So any patient GCS is less than 9, you're going to ventilate them. Because in altered sensorium, they won't have a good cough or a gag. So there is likely that they may aspirate their secretions and worsen their lungs. So you intubate them for airway protection, that is called. If you want to improve the oxygen delivery. In traumatic brain injury, your brain perfusion or autoregulation depends on your oxygen and CO2. So you want a strict CO2 levels, unlike in other conditions till now, where we followed permissive hypoxia, permissive hypercapnia. Whenever there is a problem in the brain, this permissive strategies will not work at all. You'll have to strictly maintain CO2s in the range of 35 to 45. Your saturation should always be about 94, but not 100. So always about 94. So whenever you're not able to maintain the strict CO2 targets, you go ahead with ventilation, intubation and ventilation. So for airway protection, and when you want strict CO2 controls, and whenever you have something like pneumonia associated with a traumatic brain injury or a hemothorax with traumatic brain injury, then again you go ahead with intubation and ventilation. So what is the situation where you have a TBI along with ARDS? This is also common. You have a severe traumatic brain injury and TBA. As I already said, in ARDS, our strategies are to accept permissive hypercapnia, permissive hypoxia, accepting lower saturation. But when your lung and brain are both affected, your brain takes precedence over your lung. Your brain always comes first. So at this time, your permissive strategies will not work at all. So you want saturation about 94, you have strict CO2 targets, 35 to 45. You don't use permissive strategies. Even if the tidal volume had to be increased, you go ahead with increasing the tidal volume, because your brain always comes first, because your hypoxia can cause secondary brain injury. Your hypercarbia can again increase the cerebral blood flow and increase the ICP, and it can even go into herniation. So that is again important. So how much PEEP to keep? So that is again a questionable thing. See, what you'll have to remember is, if the lungs are normal, the PEEP is likely to get, if you keep a higher PEEP, that is able to, that can get transmitted to the brain and the venous return can come down. But if your lungs are already affected, the transmissibility of the PEEP is usually less, and it has been found that for pediatrics, till a PEEP of 15, I think the venous return from the brain will not be affected. So next is myocardial dysfunction. So when do we ventilate? As I already said, whenever there is a LV dysfunction and pulmonary edema, the low EF, always better to intubate and ventilate them, because the intubation and ventilation itself is a positive inotropy and it is a very good afterload reducing agent. For LV dysfunction, the key component is afterload reduction. So that PEEP which you give itself is sufficient to recruit more alveoli and improve the pulmonary edema. But at the same time, if there is some problem in the RV, so you generally don't try to intubate them. You actually prefer early extubation, because positive pressure will increase the RV afterload and can worsen the RV function. And again, if you're ventilating for cardiac function, any cardiac babies or the, usually the children, they look very good on when the patient is on ventilator. But once you remove from the positive pressure ventilation, they'll again start developing something called flash pulmonary edema once they are extubated. So it's always, when you extubate them for LV dysfunction, just transition them gradually to a non-invasive ventilation like HFNC or a CPAP. you can even add an extra ionodilator like Meldrinone during the time, or Levosimendan, or a oral drug like Enalapril, so that the afterloads is completely reduced and they don't develop flash pulmonary edema. So again, positive pressure ventilation, this has already been discussed, decreases the pulmonary congestion by decreasing the preload. First, it reduces the preload and reduces the afterload. So both are very good for the heart. You don't know, it is like reducing the preload is like a LASIK sort of effect. Reducing the afterload is like something like a Meldrinone sort of, or a Dobutamine sort of effect. It opens up the alveoli because of the PEEP effect. And thereby, your work of breathing also comes down. When you ventilate them, your oxygen requirement comes down, work of breathing comes down. So oxygen delivery generally improves. So again, post-op cardiac surgery, I think I'll just touch on it. Usually when there is a condition like Glenn or a Fountain, usually you try to extubate them early because positive pressure hampers the passive circulation. But if you have something like a VSD or a TAPVC where the left heart is affected, you again try to ventilate them for a longer duration. Any post-op child, usually they come to us extubated. But if they are ventilated, usually it will be a long duration surgery where the anesthetic effect is sort of handling. Or if they want to give a good pain relief, usually they keep them ventilated. Usually post-op cardiac surgeries, craniofacial surgeries, complex surgeries, they sort of come ventilated to us. Usually this will be like a short ventilation. Usually you can just extubate them and proceed.